It's been a couple of days now since the live stream where Ben Irving and Mike Gamble sat down to play on the Stommen Interceptor, did some free play, and played a couple of dynamic missions out in the world. The stream itself was really fun, really nice. I actually enjoyed it quite a lot, but it didn't provide a lot of new information or nothing major enough to, you know, cover on a channel in itself. The majority of stuff that came from that was from that gameplay that we went over in another video. If you haven't seen that, do pause this video and go quickly watch it. But that's not to say that the live stream didn't provide some new information at all. It was just a lot of smaller, more minute stuff. So today I wanted to cover a lot of the smaller details that you may have missed in that live stream that I really wanted to highlight because I thought it was pretty cool. It's worth adding that some of these are fairly obvious, but if I do bring them up on this list, it's because they are important and kind of need re-emphasizing. And you know, I just wanted to bring it up again. My name is Ryan Central and welcome back to another Anthem video. I did want to know what you guys think in the comments, what stuff you really enjoyed from that stream, whether you were really happy to see some of the stuff in there. But the first thing that I want to start off with is the personalization of guns specifically. We get to see the Javelin straight away, and of course you can see that both of them are kitted out in different colors, patterns, and they look really, really cool. The whole idea is that you can personalize the look of your Javelin to look how you want it to. But what really impressed me was that this personalization element also passes over to the guns. As you can see, Mike Gamble's main weapon also shares the same color scheme. Hopefully it ends up something like Warframe, where you can just personalize and recolor every aspect of your Javelin. But I was just really impressed with the attention to detail already in the game. The next thing that I want to highlight is the third ability slot. Most gameplay we've seen has had two abilities down in the bottom right, but this time it is three. And of course, we now know that there are three abilities that each Javelin will be able to use, the third slot being predominantly support based. So not only was it nice to see that that UI was on screen, I mean kind of, most of the time it was a big red block, but also having it being used in game was also really cool. Your first ability will be bound to your left bumper, the second one to your right, and then the third support ability will be both at the same time. Mike's Storm Javelin had the Windwall ability equipped, whilst Ben was running the target beacon on his Interceptor. I'm not sure what abilities Ben was running on the melee build Interceptor, but we do know that Mike was running the Lightning Strike ability, which you are seeing on screen, and also the Ball Lightning. For the most part, we have seen the Hoarfrost shards in this slot from the gameplay last week in Paris, but so far they are the only abilities that we've physically seen from the Storm's perspective. Next up are the places that we visit in this live stream. We of course have the main gate of Fort Tarsis, which we saw quite a bit of last week too in Paris, being stood at this main walkway area. But also what was worth highlighting were the places that we visited. We went from Fort Tarsis to the Gathering Falls, which were the huge waterfalls, Edian Grove, where the first mission was, Arden's Road, which looks amazing and was really fun to fly down, the Sanctuary of Dinar, which was pretty much at World's End, where the other mission was, and then the Dark Canopy, which was just below it. It's really difficult to say how much of the overall map we went over. In the Colossus gameplay from E3, you know, the Stronghold mission, the character traveled over one sub-region of the map, and there's 10 in total, and it was roughly around the same kind of area, maybe one and a half sub-regions, but it is really hard to say. Not only do you have the distance that you travel, but also the verticality and volume element of the map. Next up, I want to highlight a really cool tactic that Mike Gamble was implementing that's called the dunk tactic, or at least that's what I'm calling it. See, when you're flying around in a Javelin, you have a overheating meter, which when you overheat completely, you will fall to the ground as you're seeing on screen. Another really cool thing to highlight. But you can stop your engines from overheating by flying near to water, as it keeps your engines cool, but you can also reset the overheating meter by either flying through a waterfall or flying into water. And so what we saw Mike Gamble doing just before they reached the end of a lake or a river was diving under the water back up again to reset that meter so he could fly for a little bit longer without having to reset. I think it's something that we're all going to be doing quite a lot of when this game comes out, so it's just worth noting that you have that knowledge beforehand. There's another really cool interaction when it comes to the Storm being in the air. See, when you're in the air as a Storm, you have this force field shield that protects you, which isn't on you when you're on the ground. However, when you lose that shield, you immediately fall to the ground and there's nothing you can do about it. It takes you straight out of the sky as soon as you lose that shield. So you want to be in the air quite a lot as a Storm, but you need to be clever with how you position yourself, otherwise you're constantly going to be going up and down. Another important factor to think about when you're playing Anthem is the difficulty settings. They were playing on a second difficulty, just one over easy, and it was the middle difficulty out of three that have been described as the introductory difficulties. Now, I've heard that the difficulty systems might be like in Diablo with the Torment levels, which would be really, really cool. Imagine trying to do all of this trash stuff on like Torment 10. Even Grabbits would look scary in that regard. But the point I'm trying to make is, even on these pretty boring mundane missions that we've all experienced in other games, you still have difficulty to mess around with. So even if you are an overgeared, absolute machine of a javelin and player, you can still find quite difficult matchups out in the open. But this difficulty is just above easy, and it still looks quite hard for the players to keep themselves alive. A cool interaction with the Storm's ultimate is that you place down three different auras of different elements. So electricity, fire, and ice. You could place them in different places or on top of one another if you want. However, the thing that I want to highlight is the final thing that you do in that ultimate is bring down meteors, and each of these meteors land in the places that you put them. For example, if you put all of these auras in three different spots, three different meteors appear and slam the ground, which is quite good if you want to hit multiple spots, but if you want to put all that damage down in one place, it's going to be really, really strong. Loot is a really important topic in Anthem, which I want to bring up another day, but some of the stuff that gets picked up on these missions are also pretty interesting. For the most part, they are weapon parts, which seem to be crafted materials as opposed to a weapon itself, but we also saw stuff like Chimeric Compound and an Uncommon Ember. No idea what that does yet, but I am desperate to find out more information on them. One thing that I really wanted to test out for myself is what happens when you fly into a wall, and we got to saw Mike Gamble do that as he flew straight into a column and hit the ground, and it looks as funny as you would expect it to. In the second public event that we saw the Dominion, which is a faction that we haven't seen an awful lot of. But what makes it even cooler is some of the mobs that came out of the Dominion. For example, the Dominion have trained wildlife in the Anthem universe and used them as weapons, as you have these Frost Hounds, which look amazing. But also you have the Dominion Valkyries, which are effectively Dominion Storm Javelins. So the enemy also have their own javelin suits that you need to be careful of. And from a lore perspective, the Storm Javelin actually came from the Dominion. The idea was stolen, and the suit was stolen, and then implemented on the good guy side. So instead of them copying us, we kind of copied them. One important factor that I did want to highlight that kind of got overlooked a little bit is the fact that this stream was played on an older build of the game. This isn't the up-to-date one, but it still showed us a lot of how far they've come and how much they've achieved in that time, ever since they announced that they were in alpha. It's not a major factor, but just an important one that I wanted to highlight. In the second mission, you have the Shaper Relic, which was actually going a little bit crazy. You had to shoot it and do damage to it to keep it under control, but if you didn't do that, the Shaper Relic would actually start to do damage to you, and you see it effectively kill Mike in this clip. I find this a really interesting interaction when you have all of the Dominion swarming over you with some big scary mobs, and not only that, you need to keep the Shaper Relic in check, which I think when you're in a team of four and there's a lot of mobs trying to kill you, it's going to get pretty crazy pretty quickly, and you need to keep on top of a lot of different stuff. So I find that a really interesting interaction that I think could be a lot of fun when playing up against it. As I said, Mike got knocked down, so we get a better look at the revive state and how reviving a teammate works, both from the perspective of being downed and being the one doing the reviving. But also, if you don't get saved, you get brought back to a checkpoint, which we saw isn't too far away from the mission that it's a problem, but you get taken out the fight for a short period of time. We didn't really get to see as much of the Interceptor as I would have liked. We didn't see any prospective gameplay, for example, from Ben, because he was in a whole different country to Mike Gamble and the rest of the BioWare people, but he did touch on how combos work for the Interceptor. For example, the ultimate was used with the different auras, as I said, the ice, fire, and electricity auras put onto the ground. Say, for example, the Interceptor is doing melee damage in the fire aura of the Storm, then I think the glaives start to set on fire and you as an Interceptor start doing fire damage, which I feel is a really cool synergy and combo that can be used. It's not as cut and dry as one javelin uses one ability, the other uses another. There's a lot of different ways how the combo interactions can work, and I think that's pretty cool. We heard a lot from Owen, often saying the same lines over and over again, but Mike pointed out that they have the same cipher, that both of them are running Owen, which might suggest that you can customize your cipher. For example, you could run Faye instead of Owen, depending on which one you liked more. And it might depend on story elements too, and how you interact with them. This one's a minor thing that I noticed from Paris last week. When a Storm Javelin's engines overheat, the arms set on fire. I'm pretty sure that these are the seals of a Storm, but I'm not inherently sure. But I did feel like that was a cool little thing to point out, that every time the Storm overheats, the suit physically sets on fire, which makes sense. There's definitely a lot of stuff that was brought up on loop progression, which I want to highlight separately, which I'll probably do in the next video. There's no healing abilities in Anthem at all. You cannot support your teammate by healing up their health. The only thing that can do that is picking up health globules on the ground. And as I pointed out earlier, you have this chimeric compound and an uncommon ember, and I really want to know what they do. A lot of the other stuff that was pointed out we knew about. For example, there's 12 pieces of gear that can affect your gameplay per javelin. You have 5 in one slot, 5 in the other, and then 2 that you can choose from in your support slot. A lot of minor stuff, I will put the link to the VOD in the description if you haven't seen it, but there isn't an awful lot of stuff. A lot of the questions that were answered we've heard a couple of times already, so some minor tidbits that I wanted to go through, but nothing major, just a lot of interesting bits and pieces that I wanted to go through. Let me know what you think of this, what you want to see from the next live stream. Let me know all that in the comments below, and I can't wait to see more. Take care, and I'll see you soon.